शौकत हयात ने अपनी किताब में लिखा है द नेशन इज लॉस्ट सोल में कि मैं पंजाब के दौरे पर था तो मुझे जिनाह साहब ने कहा कि वहाँ कादियान जाओ और मिर्ज़ा साहब से कहना, जो खलीफा दोम थे बशीरुद्दीन महमूद साहब, उनसे मेरा सलाम कहना और उनसे कहना कि हमारे लिए दुआ करें, हमारी तायद करें। तो ईशा की नमाज़ हो चुकी थी और वो घर जा चुके थे। मैंने उनसे कहा, उन्होंने कहा जी अब तो कोई मिल ही नहीं सकता, सवाल ही पता नहीं होता। उन्होंने कहा मेरा पैगाम पहुँचा दो, मुझे जिनाह साहब ने भेजा है। चुनाचे जैसे ही उन्हें मालूम हुआ कि जिनाह साहब का मैसेज आया, उन्होंने फ़ौरन बाहर आए और मुझे ले गए अंदर, खाना भी खिलाया और कहा कि दुआ भी करेंगे इंशाल्लाह, आप भी करेंगे, हमारे दामे दर में सुखने हर तरह हाजिर। तो आपने तो अपने आप ये गले लगाई ये मुसीबत।
मुल्ला एज ए क्लास अपोज्ड मुहम्मद अली जिन्ना एंड देयर अपोजिशन वाज नॉट बेस्ड अपॉन द पर्सन ऑफ जिन्ना, दे वांटेड टू अपोज मॉडर्न लिबरल मुस्लिम माइंड एंड मुहम्मद अली जिन्ना एपिटोमाइज मॉडर्न मुस्लिम माइंड। सो आई से यस एहरार अपोज मुस्लिम लीग, यस मौदूदी अपोज मुस्लिम लीग, but more so mullah, the mullah as a class opposed Muhammad Ali Jinnah.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the second episode of our series 1974 from democracy to extremism. In our previous show, we briefly touched upon a number of reasons that led to the so-called Second Amendment in the Constitution of Pakistan. In 1974, Prime Minister Zulfikar Ali Bhutto estranged himself from progressively secular and democratic forces to gratify the religious orthodoxy by introducing the relevance of religion in public policy. He was initially a man who was seen as a leftist, but now he appeared to be far from it. He was aspiring to be the political leader of the Muslims world over. At the same time, King Faisal, with his Wahhabi ideology, wanted to be the spiritual leader of the Muslims world over. With this backdrop, it is hardly surprising that the Prime Minister of that time, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, capitulated to the Mullah's demands and the Pakistan Parliament enacted the amendment to the Constitution by adding a clause in Article 260, sub-article 3, declaring the Ahmadis as non-Muslims. Today, we'll look into the background of this draconian law in more detail. But first, a quick recap of the previous episode.
1947. A country was founded. Pakistan's vision, a secular and a vibrant state.
I'm looking forward to making Pakistan as one of the greatest nations of the world.
Ahmadi Muslims play a key role in building the progressive Pakistan. First Foreign Minister of Pakistan is an Ahmadi. First Nobel laureate is also an Ahmadi. Ahmadis are contributing in building the nation in all walks of life. Ahmadis believe in tolerant and peaceful Islam. But extremists don't. After several consistently stubborn efforts, government succumbs to the pressure. Mullahs finally convinced the government of Pakistan to declare Ahmadis out of the pale of Islam. 1974, Ahmadis become non-Muslim for the purpose of law and constitution. This was the tragedy of Pakistan. 1974, from democracy to extremism.
Just like in the previous show, we once again have Mr. Rahman with us, Mr. Mujibur Rahman. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you very much. Wa alaikum assalam.
Mr. Rahman, first question is about the history of opposition to the community. Give us some details of the genesis of the opposition the community has faced.
Farooq, you see, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib of Qadian, he formally founded the community in 1889. But even before that, he was known as a very profound thinker and a very prolific writer. He had been writing on religious subjects, and with the profound books he had written, with the writing of his famous monumental book, Brahin Ahmadiyya, which I may call his magnum opus. His reputation and the stature as an intellectual of high caliber amongst the Muslim society, I should say rocketed sky high. Mm. And he was acknowledged as a great champion of Islam. And it was said that the book like the one Brahin Ahmadiyya has not been written in the last 1400 years. But then, you know, his writings and his his approval of his writings or opposition of his writing was mostly on the intellectual level. Those who differed with him, they differed on the intellectual level, and the argument was mostly polemical in nature on the religious doctrines and dogmas. And when Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib claimed to be the Mahdi and Messiah, that incensed the Muslim clergy. They could not understand that claim. It was right. It was way away from their concept of what Mahdi is going to be and how Messiah is going to be. So that incensed the Muslim clergy and the Muslim opinion. Then there was a full-blooded opposition, 200 ulama signing a fatwa of kufr against him, Saudi Arabia and all other Arab countries joining in that fatwa, and full-blooded opposition. But then, mind you, these were all very learned people.
Right.
The opposition was on the religious level, mostly polemical and mostly religious controversy.
So those edicts were purely on religious basis?
Purely on religious basis at that stage of time. So this opposition continued in his lifetime. And as the opposition grew and it gained heat, as I might say, then he was the opponents dragged him to the courts also. And further, we have mentioned that he was taken to the court of Captain Douglas by Henry Martin Clark, who was a bishop. So in his lifetime, the whole controversy was polemical, religious, on dogma, on intellectual level. Here and there was opposition which was going out of the intellectual level and going down to the level of political persecution. But in his lifetime, it remained there. After his lifetime, it changed a little. But in his lifetime also, which I must say, there are certain events which were a pointer to what is going to happen in future.
Right.
In his lifetime, in 1876, Indian National Congress was formed.
Right.
In 1906, All India Muslim League was formed in Dhaka.
The Congress was formed before his claim of being prophet.
Yeah.
And Muslim League was after.
Two years before his death, Muslim League was formed. Mm. So what I'm saying is that with the close of his life, the colonial rulers were departing. And therefore, the whole dialogue, the whole narrative changed in the whole of India. And so that also happened with Jamaat-e-Ahmadiyya also. So after his death, the opposition took religious as well as political angles.
Thank you very much. So the opposition of the peaceful Ahmadiyya Muslim community was rising ever so sharply.
Majlis Ahrar-e-Islam, or Ahrar for short, is a political party founded in 1931 in the Indian subcontinent. It is a party associated with the opposition of the founder of Pakistan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, his visions and struggles for an independent Pakistan. It is also well known for its hatred of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. One of its founders, Ataullah Shah Bukhari, a religious leader, was later to be at the forefront of persecution of Ahmadis in Pakistan.
Whatever Ahmadiyya Muslim community was doing for the benefit of Muslims of subcontinent, Ahrar, always they were against that. In 1934, they organized a gathering near Qadian, and the only agenda of that gathering was to spread hate against Ahmadiyya Muslim community.
Only 2 years after their foundation, they passed a resolution that no Ahmadi should be elected to any public body and insisted that all Ahmadis in public service should be removed from their positions. In 1947, they failed in their mission to prohibit a Pakistan.
बात यह है कि मजलिस एरार का तो मसला यह है कि उन्होंने पाकिस्तान की मुखालफत की थी और उन्होंने उसे ओन किया था कि हमने पाकिस्तान की मुखालफत की है हम हार गए जिनाह साहब जीत गए लेकिन जमा इस्लामी का मौका जमा इस्लामी ने तो ना पाकिस्तान उसी किताब में सर जफरुल्ला वो जो थे शौकत हयात की किताब में उन्होंने कहा कि मैं उसके बाद फिर मौलाना मौलवी के पास गया जिनाह साहब ने कहा कि उनके पास भी जाओ उन्होंने कहा कि हम तो इसे ना पाकिस्तान समझते हैं हम कैसे पाकिस्तान की हिमायत कर सकते हैं हमसे वो कैसे मुतालबा कर सकते हैं हमारा तो कोई ताल्लुक ही नहीं लेकिन पाकिस्तान बनने के बाद एकदम इन्होंने जमा इस्लामी ने पलटा खाया और जनाब वो उन्होंने कहा जनाब पाकिस्तान तो बनाया ही हमने
After their failure, they raised their campaign against the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in Pakistan. The Ahrar opposition movement climaxed during the peak of the Punjab disturbances in 1953.
और उसकी बुनियाद ये थी कि अताउल्लाह शाह बुखारी और شاہ جی نے یہاں آ کر کہا کہ جی ہم مسلم لیگ جیت گئی اور ہم ہار گئے, ہمیں مجبوراً پاکستان آنا پڑا اور ہم پاکستان میں اب سیاست نہیں کریں گے. اب ایک آدمی کو جس کو ساری عمر جلسے جلوس سارے کچھ کرنے کی عادت ہو, ایک ہنگامہ اور شور و شغب میں اس نے زندگی گزاری ہو, اسے کچھ نہ کچھ کرنے کے لیے چاہیے. یہاں آ کے انہوں نے کہا جی اب ہم یہ کام کریں گے, اور انہوں نے اس کو بنیاد بنا کر, اور چنانچہ اس کے بعد اس وقت وہ ہمارے والد کے پاس آئے تھے یہاں, اور انہوں نے کہا تھا کہ جناب جماعت اسلامی جو ہے وہ اس تحریک میں حصہ لے. انہوں نے کہا کہ نہیں, ہم تو اس وقت کانسٹیٹیوشن میں بنانے میں اور اس میں اسے اسلامی بنانے میں مصروف ہیں, ہمارے پاس ٹائم نہیں ہے, ہم ساتھ نہیں دے سکتے. چاہے عطا اللہ شاہ بخاری یہ لوگ ان کے خلاف ہو گئے تھے.
وہ تم کو حسین
Fanaticism entered a new era as it was now endorsed by the parliament. Persecution of Ahmadis is made lawful. Now the law prevents Ahmadis from claiming themselves to be Muslims. Not only this, Ahmadis are also deprived of the right to act like Muslims and practice the Islamic teachings. Since then, hundreds of Ahmadis have been beaten, tortured, imprisoned, and even killed in Pakistan just for one crime. Ahmadis claim to be Muslims.
Mr. Rahmana, looking at the vision of Pakistan and then what's happening now, why is such a huge change?
You see, people have looked at it from different angles, but one angle which I would like to highlight, that in the creation of Pakistan, as I said, it was a mass movement. All sections of Muslim population, all different sects, different hues of opinions, different shades of opinion were included in that mass. And therefore, within the ranks and files of Muslim League, there was a bug of fundamentalism present. The Muslim, well, for example, Maulana Shabbir Ahmad Usmani was a part of Muslim League and was a prominent leader of Muslim League. And as it came to light subsequently, even a person of the stature of Khwaja Nazimuddin, who was so close to Qaid-e Azam, in the 1953 Munir inquiry, he disowned the idea of Pakistan as envisioned by Qaid-e Azam. That is strange. So that bug was very much there, and it took time, and then it took the shape of 1949 resolution, whatever. We'll come to that later.
Yeah.
But that bug was present even amongst the most senior members of the Muslim League.
Okay, so the new nation came into being, and the Constituent Assembly was given a very clear vision for a progressive and fair Pakistan. In less than 2 years of the birth of Pakistan, and after the death of Jinnah, for example, the Constituent Assembly came up with the so-called Objectives Resolution.
In order to stem the Mullah's mobilization of mass support, in 1949, the Pakistan government sought a compromise with them by passing the Objectives Resolution, which constituted a statement of intent regarding the content of the future constitution of Pakistan. This resolution was deliberately worded as a vague pledge to incorporate Islamic principles into the constitution, but also envisaged the guaranteeing of complete religious freedom for religious minorities. Within this context, superior courts fashioned doctrines that unhesitatingly provided unequivocal protection of freedom of religious beliefs.
The beginning of fundamentalism in Pakistan, which as a matter of fact determined the role of Pakistan, it was in 1949 Objective Resolution. Because Objective Resolution, though it was a preamble, it was, so far it was not, of course there was no constitution, because the first constitution, it was made in 1956. But Objective Resolution, you know, created an idea about the state of Pakistan. And this idea was that Pakistan should be a religious state, you know. So, you know, it was the base, which on this basis later on the constitutions, you know, they were made, and the Islamic provisions were made in the different constitution 1956, constitution 1962, and the constitution 1973.
Mr. Rahman, we've seen briefly what Objective Resolution actually was. In view of Pakistan's vision initially, and looking at the words of Objective Resolution, how do you see the two? How do you compare the two?
We have right now seen only the opening clause of the objective resolution. Mm-hmm. Objective resolution is a bit longer document. When you read the whole of the document, many aspects will become clear to you. But the main point is that after partition, the Muslim clergy and the Muslim Orthodox opinion started pushing the founding fathers of Pakistan towards an Islamic state, and they had an enlightened vision, so they made certain compromises. This objective resolution, mind you, was adopted during the lifetime of Liaquat Ali Khan, but after the lifetime of Muhammad Ali Jinnah.
Liaquat Ali Khan being the first Prime Minister of Pakistan.
So many people have said if the objective resolution were tabled in the lifetime of Jinnah, he would never have allowed it.
Right.
But Liaquat Ali Khan made compromises. There were reasons for the compromises. Of course, he had his difficulties, but then he did not have his own constituency here. He felt very weak. And he, in any case, he was pushed to that position where the demand of the fundamentalist lobby were to an extent accepted. But objective resolution was not altogether a very wrong document, I would say, for finding it a better word. Mm. Objective resolution was a combination of many things. Mm. It was full of compromises. Mm. The first clause, which was read, whereas the sovereignty over the entire universe belongs to Almighty Allah alone. Mm. Now that sovereignty of Allah, the concept of the Orthodox Muslims, that sovereignty of Allah in accordance with the objective resolution was not to be exercised by the clerics as the divine right of the given from the God. That right to be, in the very sentence that we have read here, that right to be exercised by the chosen representatives of the people. Yes. So the chosen representative, the concept of democracy was put in there. So there was a compromise between the democracy and sovereignty of Allah. Strictly speaking, in democracy, the sovereignty belongs to masses. But leaving that question apart, so there were certain saving graces in the objective resolution. Another saving grace was that of the Islamic state, of the concept of the clerics, would not give Muslims the equal right of citizens. They would be treated as second-rate citizens, as zimmis or whatever. But objective resolution clearly said that our constitution will give equal protection to the minorities. Mm-hmm. The objective resolution also envisioned the fundamental rights to protect the rights. So all that is in our constitution, later on incorporated in the constitution, was given in the objective resolution also. So objective resolution was not altogether a pernicious document. There were pernicious openings into it, no doubt.
Right.
It gave a twist to the political thought. It gave a turn to the political movement in Pakistan, but everything was not lost, because Liaquat Ali and the people like him, they were hard put to explain to the assembly that we are not going to be a theocratic state.
Right.
He repeated again and again and again, Pakistan is not going to be a theocratic state. So the clerics gained a little, and the democratic forces retained a little, so it was a compromise.
It was in balance at that stage.
Balance or tilt on one side or the other, but something was retained, everything was not lost. It was lost later on. How and why, we shall see.
Right. So we can perhaps view the objective resolution, as Mujibur Rahman Saab has said, that as a vague pledge to incorporate Islamic principles into the constitution, but also it can be seen to be assuring complete religious freedom for religious minorities. Now, what happens 4 years later? Pakistan's various religious orthodox groups were incapable of agreeing upon even the most basic questions in Islam. Anti-Ahmadi sentiment was fostered by the mullahs in order to create an issue of a unifying force, namely the excommunication of the Ahmadi community, as the Pakistan government resisted the mullahs in 1953. These hardliners staged explosive riots against the Ahmadi Muslim community.
As Pakistan's various religious orthodox groups were incapable of agreeing upon even the most basic theological questions, anti-Ahmadi sentiment was fostered by the mullahs in order to create an issue of unifying force, namely the excommunication of the Ahmadis.
It was a three-point agenda, very succinct, that Ahmadis should be declared outside the pale of Islam, that Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan should be removed as the foreign minister of Pakistan, and Ahmadis should be removed from all important or key governmental positions. And if you will not accept that, we will start direct action, meaning street agitation.
As the Pakistan government resisted the mullahs, in 1953, the mullahs staged explosive riots against Ahmadis. In these riots, Ahmadis were massacred and their properties looted and destroyed. Government authorities came down heavily upon the rioters and arrested, tried and imprisoned the mullahs who instigated the riots. Neither the Pakistan government nor the judicial inquiry, which investigated the matter, blamed the riots on the Ahmadis nor on their religious beliefs. Instead, responsibility was placed on the shoulders of the mullahs, who were found to have incited the agitation with a political rather than religious motive.
Now let's take a look at some more details, and we take the views of a keen researcher and an author of history, Dr. Mr. Sultan Ahmed from Pakistan. Aslam Ali Dr. Saab, why in 53 those riots ended up so disastrously?
Firstly, we should understand that at that time, that is in 1953, as compared with 1974 and as compared with 1984 and as compared with what's going on today, society in Pakistan was generally much more tolerant. Much more religious tolerance was present as compared with today. Secondly, we should understand this thing that these opponents of Jamaat, these religious political parties, they always need some patron in the government circles so that they can carry on their activity. At that time, that is in 1953 and in the years before 1953, Punjab government, provincial government of Punjab was putting them under the chief ministership of Mumtaz Daultana Sahab. But on the other hand, the other provincial governments like NWFP government, like Bengal government, they were not supporting them. And central government, though they failed to take concrete action against the agitation, still they were not supporting them. So what happened? When the agitation started and the riots started, they were confined to the few cities of Punjab and the rest of the country was calm. That was a great setback to them. Thirdly, when the riots gained their momentum in the early weeks of March 1953 and reached their climax on 9th of March 1953, then Mumtaz Daultana Sahab, according to a well thought of conspiracy, he rang the prime minister. At that time, on that particular day, Ahmadis were being killed on the streets, their property was being looted, their shops, their houses, their factories were being burnt. But Mumtaz Daultana Sahab rang the Prime Minister, Khwaja Nazimuddin, and said, I cannot control this situation. You'll have to accept their demands, otherwise Lahore will be in fire by tonight. Unfortunately for him, but fortunately for Pakistan, Khwaja Nazimuddin was sitting in a cabinet meeting. He was horrified. He told the cabinet ministers that what's happening in Lahore. But two of the federal ministers stood up and they stood firm. They said, what sort of government is this that cannot control the law and order? We cannot be blackmailed like this. They rang Corps Commander Lahore and asked about the situation. He said that I can control the situation within few hours. So that was it. The army moved in, martial law was imposed on the city of Lahore, and within hours this drama was over.
So it must be quite unnerving times for Pakistan in those days, especially in Lahore. So what were the consequences, Dr. Ahmed, of those riots in 1953?
The 1953 riots led to far-reaching consequences. Many bad precedents were set in so many different ways. For example, that was the first time in the history of Pakistan that religious riots occurred like this, and the people were killed on the street for their religious beliefs, and this history was repeated many times later on. This was the first time that mosques were used to incite religious intolerance and hatred, and that is still going on, unfortunately. And that was the first time in 1953 that a religious issue was used for gaining political favors or for gaining political mileage, and that is still going on. And if we talk about the political stability, then in 1953, it was the first time that provincial government clashed with the central government. And that also happened many times later on. And that was the first time that federal government had to dismiss provincial government. Khwaja Nazimuddin, the Prime Minister of Pakistan, dismissed the provincial government of Punjab. And later on, what happened that head of the state, Ghulam Muhammad, had to dismiss the cabinet and the prime minister, Khwaja Nazimuddin Sahab. And that history was also repeated many times later on in Pakistan, and that created political instability. That was the first time in 1953 that martial law was imposed, though it was confined to the city of Lahore. But martial law was imposed in Pakistan in 1953 for the first time. Then this history was repeated at least three times later on. So in so many different ways, we see that if we are to pinpoint one turning point when the country turned away from the ideals of Qaedism Muhammad Ali Jinnah towards the fiasco we are seeing right now, then 1953 is that turning point.
Right, so we know that the causes of Lahore disturbances were put to judicial inquiry and commission was constituted consisting of Justice Munir and Justice Kiani. Mr. Rahman, what was the area or what were the areas that were covered in that report?
You see, the inquiry, Munir Inquiry Commission was entrusted with the task of finding out the causes of the disturbances, to apportion the blame or responsibility, who was responsible. And the Munir Inquiry of course considered the demands that were placed before Khwaja Nazimuddin, the demands which led to the agitation. The demands were three. Number one, Ahmadis should be declared as non-Muslim minority. Number two, Zafrullah Khan should be removed from the office of the foreign minister. Number three, Ahmadis should be removed for all key posts. Now, these demands could not be accepted by any sensible government, having any modicum of understanding of the politics and the country and the human rights. They could not have accepted that. Now, the demand, as Dr. Sultan Ahmed has pointed out, the provincial government diverted the agitation towards the central government.
Right.
And Khwaja Nazimuddin at the central government, he was a thorough gentleman, a very sincere Muslim, but for the same reason, he was a very weak person.
Right.
He did not straight away reject the demand, and the inquiry committee has gone into that question. He did not straight away reject the demand. He took time, tried to appease the Muslim.
So just to recap, so the provincial government actually passed the buck on to...
Passed the buck on, and the word has been used. The provincial government passed on the baby to the central government, so
right.
to say. But then...
So there was Mumtaz Daultana
and Mumtaz Daultana versus the Khwaja Nazimuddin.
Right, okay.
That story we shall talk later.
Okay.
But Khwaja Nazimuddin, being a gentleman, tried to persuade the ulama and to see reason, but they did not. So the inquiry committee has also dealt with this aspect, why Khwaja Nazimuddin did not take a prompt action. That is one area which they covered. Apart from the responsibility of the disturbances, which were squarely placed on Majlis-e-Arar and Jamaat-e-Islami and the provincial government, etc., etc. But they also pointed out that there was one reason why the disturbances took place, but there was no prompt decision by the central government. But then they said, now, if we have to consider the demand that Ahmadis should be declared as non-Muslim, we need to know who a Muslim is. So let's have a definition of Muslim.
Right, interesting.
So they tried very hard. They brought all the ulama together, and none of them could agree on the definition of Muslim.
Right.
And ultimately, the Munir said, well, all of them disagree and all of them hold each other as non-believers or heretics or kafirs. If we accept the definition of one, we will be heretics in the eyes of the others.
Right.
And if we give a definition of our own, we will be heretics in the eyes of everybody, the whole ummah.
So it's not worthwhile effort to find out what Muslim actually means.
So no definition could be reached there. Then they also tried to examine other questions. All right, you want an Islamic state. What is the concept of an Islamic state? Maulana Maududi and Maulana Amin Hasan Islahi and all the great scholars that appeared before the assembly, they were asked about the concept of an Islamic state. They did not have an idea of what an Islamic state should be in the modern age.
Right.
They talked of the concepts of 1400 years of 1000 years old.
So you mentioned the names from people from Jamaat-e-Islami.
Jamaat-e-Islami.
So who other people and, were there? Ahrar, Jamaat-e-Islami?
Ahrar, Jamaat-e-Islami, Jamiatul Ulama, and the Shia Council and something, all sects
and the Ahmadi Muslim community as well,
Ahmadi Muslim
with the second Khalifa.
So they could not give a definition, they could not give the outlines of a Muslim state. But then when the Munir probed them further and put them particularly, this is the vision of Qaid-e-Azam of a state, what do you say of that? And you know, This Amin Hasan Aslahi had the cheek to say, this concept of state is devil's creation. We will not accept it. And then they were asked questions about the status of non-Muslims. They one and all, they said they will be second-rate citizens. And Maulana Maududi was asked, if you treat non-Muslim like this in this country, and the India treats Muslims like shooters and militias and outcasts, what would you do? It is their country, they can do what they like. Right. Not bothered about what will happen to the Muslim or around the world.
So is this report a voluminous document?
It's a report of about 600 pages.
Right.
I'll read you a paragraph of that report. Okay. It's very interesting. In his evidence, Khaja Nazimuddin used a very apt simile while complaining that Mr. Daultana wished him to hold the baby. If the demands be compared to a baby, the whole subject of responsibility can be put into a single sentence, and that is that the RR gave birth to a baby and offered it to ulama for adoption, who agreed to father it, and that anticipating that a baby would cause mischief if it grew up in the province, Mr. Daultana cast it on a canal dug with the assistance of Mr. Noor Ahmed, watered by the press, and Mr. Daultana himself to flow down Moses-like to Khaja Nazimuddin.
Right.
Okay? So the baby was driven to Khaja Nazimuddin, who, in the apparent good looks of the baby, noticed a frown and something indefinably sinister, and therefore refusing to take it in its lap, threw it away.
Right.
So he threw away the baby, with the result that the baby kicked and raised up a row, and which enveloped the province of its birth and threw both Khaja Nazimuddin and Daultana out of office. But then he had a very interesting. The baby is still alive and waiting for someone to pick up. And in this God-gifted state of Pakistan, there are careers for everybody. Political brigands, adventurers, non-entities. Mm. 20 years later, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto picked up the baby.
Yeah.
Whether he was a political brigand or an adventurer or a non-entity, I don't know.
Yes, Mr. Rahman says the baby was adopted in 1974 by Bhutto.
Is that after that report, for 20 years plus, this issue, nobody dared to go there. So I think the longevity of what the statement of the report was as to how a country needs to be governed vis-a-vis this issue, namely people's religious beliefs and religious practices and the duty of the state to furnish protection to all, irrespective of whether they are a minority view or a majority view. So until 74, this became practically a non-issue. So I think the history itself shows that it worked. As most perpetrators were brought to justice, Maulana Niazi and Maulana Maududi were sentenced by the military courts. True that after the constitution was adopted and when Sohrawardi became prime minister, he let them out. But they let them out not because he thought that, oh, what you guys did was right, but in the sense that, okay, that's a closed chapter now. We're starting a new day. Constitution has been adopted. It sort of looks like a march towards democracy is starting. So let's bygone be bygones and let's all move on. And in terms of the Ahmadi question, particularly Ahmadi presence socially, culturally, intellectually, in offices of power and offices of whatever, resumed and continued normally till 1974. So I think that evidence speaks for itself that the society at large accepted both the conclusions of responsibility and the recommendations of how decent, modern constitutional societies have to operate.
We have pointed that out more than once, that Mullah is a treacherous proposition when brought into politics.
secular political leadership or state apparatus may believe that they are exploiting or using mullah to their own benefit. But there is always an internal agenda with the mullah. They are averse to follow any dictation because they believe they are destined to rule. They believe they have been divinely appointed, chosen people to rule. So therefore, when a modern day educated person like Mumtaz Zaltana or Zulfikar Ali Bhutto assumes that he can use mullahs, he is in for a shock. That was the shock received by Mr. Mumtaz Zaltana in April 1953. That was the shock which Mr. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto received in July 1977, because he also thought along the same lines. He thought by declaring Ahmadis non-Muslim, he could win over the Muslim popularity, which was, so to speak, mullah's domain. He could not. Mullah has been around for 1400 plus years. He knows all the ins and outs of power. He has been part of the scramble for power, struggle for power. The secular, professional political leaders must stick to political discourse and not get embroiled into religious polemics, doctrinal questions. Whenever they do that, they get frustrated, they get defeated, and their defeat goes without saying. It is inevitable. That's exactly what happened in 1956.
The Constituent Assembly promulgates first indigenous constitution and decides the country shall be Islamic Republic of Pakistan. 1970, Pakistan holds its first free democratic elections. 1971, country is divided. East Pakistan becomes Bangladesh. 1973, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto becomes Prime Minister. 29th April 1973, Azad Kashmir Assembly passes resolution to declare Ahmadis non-Muslim. 14th August 1973, new constitution comes into effect. 22nd to 24th February 1974, OIC summit in Lahore. April 1974, Muslim World League passes resolution in Saudi Arabia to declare Ahmadis non-Muslim. 29th May 1974, Rabwa railway station incident. May to October 1974, countrywide anti-Ahmadiyya riots. 7th September 1974, Ahmadis declared non-Muslim through Second Amendment in the Constitution.
Now we go back to Dr. and Mrs. Sultan Ahmed in Pakistan. Dr. Ahmed, in the timeline we have just mentioned that the Kashmir Assembly resolution in 1973 was also passed. Please give us some more details of that particular resolution.
In 1973, Sardar Abdul Qayyum was the president of Kashmir, and he has been active against Jamaat-e-Ahmadiyya for so many years. And his party was the majority party in Kashmir Assembly. On 29th of April 1973, on that particular day, for some reason, opposition has boycotted the session of the Kashmir Assembly. And at that time, one of the members of Kashmir Assembly, Major Ayub, moved a resolution against Jamaat-e-Ahmadiyya. And that resolution stated that Ahmadis that Ahmadis should be declared non-Muslim in Kashmir. They should be separately registered in Kashmir, and their preaching by them should be banned. And fourth clause was that entry of Ahmadis in the state should be forbidden, but this particular clause was deleted before its approval by the assembly. Then this resolution was moved and it was approved by the assembly. So it is very clear when we go through this resolution that the ultimate plan, the master plan, was not just to declare Ahmadis non-Muslim in the constitution. The master plan, the actual plan, was to deprive them of their basic human rights.
Right, so what was the background of this resolution, Dr. Ahmed?
Well, in 1973, that is after the setback of 1971, the country was still emerging from the times of martial law. There was no permanent constitution at that time in Pakistan. A parliamentary committee was working in drafting that constitution for Pakistan. When that constitution was approved by Pakistan National Assembly, that is on 12th of April 1973, then one thing was quite worth noting in that constitution, and that was in the schedule that contained the prescribed oaths for the president and prime minister of Pakistan. In this oath, it was stated that the president or prime minister of Pakistan will have to take the oath that I am a Muslim and I believe in the Quran, and I believe in the Quran being the last book of Allah. And also there was a few sentences that I believe that Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the last of the prophet, and there can be no prophet after him. All these details about religious beliefs that made one thing very clear, that the target of this these particular changes in this schedule was to make sure that no Ahmadi can take this oath. And just imagine that on 12th of April 1973, this constitution was approved by the National Assembly of Pakistan. And just after 2 weeks, the Kashmir Assembly passed the resolution against Ahmadis. And the proponents of that resolution in the Kashmir Assembly, in support of their proposal, they quoted the newly approved constitution of Pakistan, that it is written in such a way in the constitution of Pakistan that if a president and prime minister says that he's a Muslim, then he'll have to admit that he believes in the finality of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in a very well-planned way, step by step, the country was moving towards the second constitutional amendment.
Dr. Ahmed, what was the general reaction to this resolution, and what were its long-term and short-term consequences?
There were three types of reaction to this resolution. Number one was from the opponents of Jamaat-e-Ahmadiyya in Pakistan, like Jamaat-e-Islami, Jamiatul Ulama Pakistan, so Amir of Jamaat-e-Islami, Tufail Muhammad. He immediately demanded that now the Pakistani constitution should be amended to declare Ahmadis, Qadianis as non-Muslim. And similar demand was made by Shah Ahmad Nurani that's now Ahmadis should be declared as non-Muslim in Pakistan too. And they quoted the resolution passed by Kashmir Assembly in favor of their proposals. And throughout Pakistan, these ulamas, in their Friday sermons, they quoted this resolution to ignite people against Ahmadis and to incite hatred against Ahmadis. Thirdly, a very particular reaction came from Rabta-e-Alam-e-Islami, that is World Muslim League. Their secretary immediately issued a statement that all Muslim countries should follow the example of Kashmir Assembly and declare Qadianis as non-Muslims. And he sent a telegram of congratulation, not to the president of Kashmir, but to the prime minister, to Mr. Bhutto, who was a leader in Pakistan, that this is a very applaudable work by the Kashmir Assembly, and other countries should follow their example. So this showed that this thing will not be confined to Pakistan and Kashmir. Now other countries will also participate in this conspiracy against Ahmadis.
Now we have finally reached 1974, but 1974 was an extremely eventful year too. Before the parliamentary proceedings of 1974, a series of events unfolded that provided us with all those pieces of jigsaw puzzle to complete the darkest picture in the modern world's constitutional history. We are here to gather all those links and present to you the complete picture of this journey from democracy to extremism. Assalamu alaikum.
Our history is totally distorted over the years, and that has created many problems, including the religious extremism in Pakistan. And I believe that if we correct our history and if we remove the distortions from our history, then many problems will be solved. And I have talked to many rulers in Pakistan at the top class many times. Twice with Benazir Bhutto and about 3-4 months back with the Chief Minister of Punjab. In our present day history, we have removed the idea of creation of Pakistan through a democratic process. Subcontinent was not divided on the basis of religion. It was divided because the Muslim minority, which was a very special type of minority, 25% population is not a minority in the real sense of the word, but since 75% people were non-Muslims, therefore they become minority. Muslims were backward, poor, and underdeveloped as compared to non-Muslim population of India because of many historical reasons. Nowhere this was mentioned that the division would be according to Islamic ideology or Islamic state. Nowhere in Muslim League papers, they have been published by the government of Pakistan. The original documents are saved in archives. Nowhere in those documents, nowhere in the speeches of Muslim League leaders, Islamic State, the word Islamic State has been used.
Well, there's a very famous speech that Jinnah made about you will be free, you can go to your temples, you can go to your mosques, you can go to your churches, you can pray as you like. And that speech set the tone, if you like, for the development of a liberal and multi-faith Pakistan in which everybody would be able to worship in the way that they wanted. But I think that Jinnah was not perhaps fully in touch with the way that developments were happening in Pakistan. He had been in exile, of course, before that, and his vision was really something that couldn't be accomplished. And as it turned out, things went in the wrong direction. And the rights that people had, or should have had, in accordance with that speech, to worship as they wanted and to develop their own faith, gradually became more and more circumscribed and limited as the history of Pakistan developed. And you mentioned 74 in particular, which was, if you like, a watershed in the limitations on the rights of Pakistanis to worship as they wanted.
Mr. Jinnah wanted to have secular values in society, and he definitely wanted equality for citizens. For example, you know, the first finance minister of, the first law minister of Pakistan was a Hindu. Then, you know, the foreign minister that we had later was an Ahmadi. So I think he did wanted, greater plurality in society and in, you know, decision making.
If you recall the 11th August speech, he was focused on the rights of the minorities. And I think that is reflected in our constitution even today. Equality of status in the eyes of law for all minorities.
There should not be, people should not, they should work very diligently for the promotion of peace and for the development of Pakistan as a modern state. They should work hard. Work, work, and work was the slogan given by him. And then he had said that you are free. We are starting a new phase today. You are free. As a free nation, you are free to go to your temples. You are free to go to your mosques or any other place of worship you want to. It has nothing to do with the business of politics. For political purposes, all citizens of Pakistan will have equal rights. Then he summed up his speech. The last paragraph of his speech was that if you follow this policy, you will see that after some times, Hindus will cease to be Hindus and Muslims will cease to be Muslims. Not in the religious sense. This is a very important part of this sentence. Not in the religious sense, because religion is a personal matter of faith for every individual. But for political purposes, all citizens of Pakistan will have equal rights.
This tragic story is approaching fast its climax. But the story remains incomplete without fully comprehending Jinnah's vision.
To set the things right in Pakistan, and that is possible only if we eliminate distortions from our history. And I believe that that is possible only if our educated people, if our intellectuals who claim to be intellectuals, writers, teachers, artists, if they, with courage, they reject these ideas of obscurantists and obscurantism and openly and vocally with courage say that we reject these ideas and we believe in a democratic state as Qaid Azam had visualized.
In 1974, the turning point. How fanaticism in Pakistan entered the books of law, lifting the veil of secrecy after four decades of oblivion.
Mr. Bhutto had a great desire to be the leader of Islamic world. Another man who wanted to be the leader, and he was a friend of Mr. Bhutto, was King Faisal.
In 1974, the official delegation of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community to the National Assembly of Pakistan was led by the third successor of the Prophet Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Nasir Ahmad.
Yeh dua